In the year 507 BC, the Athenian leader Callisthenes introduced a system of political reforms that he calls democratia, or rule by the people. The city of Athens lived under a democratic from that date to 322 BC. For the earlier dates, there was democracy to be found here and there in the government of Athens, and democratic institutions survived long after the latter dates, but for those 186 years, Athens was silently democratic and prosperous. This system was comprised of three separate institutions: the Ecclesia, a sovereign governing body that wrote laws and dictated foreign policy; the Bule, a council of representatives from the 10 Athenian tribes; and the Dicasteria, popular courts in which citizens argued cases before a group of larger selected jurors, although this Athenian democracy would survive for only two centuries. Around 406 BC, under the rule of the general Pericles, Athenian democracy began to evolve into something that we would call an aristocracy, the rule of what Herodotus called the one man, the best. Though democratic ideals and processes did not survive in ancient Greece, Callisthenes' intention was one of the ancient Greece's most enduring contributions to the modern world.
Since the beginning of civilization, models of regimes has been changed and modified. At the beginning of these civilizations, absolute monarchy was the most common regime in the world. By the time, democratic regimes were getting more and more common. The first model of these regimes were seen in ancient Greece, especially in Athens. The democracy model of Athens is the first known direct democracy of the history. Of course, it doesn't mean that every person could be part of the decision system. However, there was no social stratum in decision-making procedure. Citizens of Athens did not select delegates for assembly, they decided laws by voting. In politics structure of Athens, there were several government units. It is known there was three different political structure which were comprised of aristocrats. These were king, who was the pontiff at the same time, polemarchos, which means commander-in-chief and who managed military forces, and delegates of civil authority, which were called archons. However, the right to govern was belonged to assembly, which was called ecclesia. Ecclesia was the people's assembly, and it was comprised from all male citizens of Athens who were older than 20 years old. In that assembly, public officers were selected, laws were introduced. Moreover, decisions which were about wars, peace, and alliances were also made in assembly by unanimity of votes. Furthermore, Athens were earning money by voting in this assembly. This payment provided that the poor did not get further away from governing the country. In that way, stability were provided from every segment of society. The members of assembly meet once a 10 days and approximately 5,000 members went to govern their country generally.
The Bule is deliberative council in ancient Greece that is assigned to handle daily affairs of the city. Originally, the Bule was a council of nobles advising the king. In Athens, which is known as Areopagus, in 594 BC, Solon did not abolish the Areopagite council but replaced it with a new one, which was called the Bule of 400, based on 100 men from each of the four tribes. After the reforms of Callisthenes, the number of members was increased to 500, consisted of 50 men from each of the 10 tribes in 508 BC. The council was chosen by lottery and consisted of men who were at least 30 years old. All the council representatives' term was 1 year, and they could get in twice in their lifetime. Unlike the Ecclesia, the Bule met every day except festival days. The most important task of the Athenian Bule was to draft deliberations for discussion and approval in the Ecclesia. The Bule also directed finance, controlled the maintenance of the fleet and the cavalry, judged the fitness of the magistrates elect, received foreign ambassadors, advised the strategy in military manners, and could be given special powers by the Ecclesia in an emergency.
The most common way of voting in the Athenian assembly was known as hierotonia, which meant the raising of the hand. Every decision would be made by choosing between two options only, no more, no less. The voters would choose either yes or no, or vote in favor of option A or option B. The officials would judge the outcome of the vote by sight. But this was no easy task, since counting accurately the thousands of raised hands would have been probably tedious and cumbersome, if not outright impossible. As a result, the Athenians did not even try it. Instead, the officials presiding over the assembly would simply judge which option was favored by the majority. When the first round of voting failed to indicate a clear result, a second round of voting commenced in the hopes that this time a clear majority would be produced. A small category of votes required a quorum of 6,000 citizens. One such vote would have been necessary in order for a foreigner to be granted citizenship. For such a vote, the voters would be presented with two pebbles, known as psephi. One was white and the other black. At the end of the electoral debate, each voter would cast one of the pebbles into a large jar made of clay. Afterwards, the clay jar would be cracked open and the votes counted. Once a year, the Athenian Assembly decided whether or not to hold an ostracism. This was a procedure which would have ended with one man being sent into an honorable exile, which would have lasted 10 years. It was not necessary for the victim to be proven guilty in order to be expelled from the community. This system was used by the Athenians as a way to choose between rival political leaders so that the winner remained in Athens and the loser was sent away, all of this for the good and well-being of the city. When such a procedure was held, a special voting session was employed in the Agora, the main square of Athens. Each voter inscribed the name of the man he wanted to be removed from the city on an ostrakon, a piece of broken pottery. If the quorum of 6,000 citizens was met, the man with the most votes had to go into exile. Undoubtedly, some citizens voted against personal enemies, but the ones who got the most votes were obviously public figures.